Without that meticulous technique and no anesthetic, remember, the operation would have been unthinkable. But John Hunter did it in 25 minutes flat. And he says in his diary, the man did not cry out once. So this is John Burley's monstrous tumour. Look at this. This is a parotid tumour on the side of the face, and the facial nerve could be anywhere. And the thing that every surgeon dreads is cutting the facial nerve, which would leave his face paralysed. And here we see the result of the surgery with the scar afterwards. What Hunter has done is to make his incision sufficiently beyond the back of the tumour to avoid the facial nerve. That meant an excellent knowledge of anatomy. So he leaves this scar with no trace of facial paralysis, an eyelid that doesn't droop, and a straight mouth. A remarkable result.
John Hunter wrote three great treatises, which became the standard works on human teeth, gunshot wounds, and venereal disease. He was appointed Surgeon Extraordinary to the King and became the highest paid surgeon in the land. But behind all his great achievements was a driving interest in the workings of the human body. He collected specimens of everything, and the interested and the well-connected all came to see his wonderful museum of anatomical curiosities. Much of his collection was destroyed.
And this is the Hunterian Museum, where the rest of the collection is preserved at the Royal College of Surgeons.
The museum is a testament to Hunter's passion for scientific experimentation and to his obsessive desire for collection. While his friend Banks had set sail for Tahiti to find the most extraordinary specimens he could, Hunter was scarcely less extreme.
There's one last story about Hunter that I can't resist telling. It's about his interest in abnormalities and mutations. And intriguingly, it's hinted at in the Reynolds painting, here.
These feet once belonged to a man called Charles Byrne, who eked out a living at fairgrounds and freak shows, calling himself the Irish Giant. John Hunter badly wanted him for his museum.
The story goes that Byrne was so frightened of being dissected after his death that he asked his friends to bury him at sea in a lead coffin. But his friends betrayed him for money. Well, whether this is true or not, we don't know. But certainly we know that Hunter paid £130 for the body, a lot of money in today's terms, about £15,000. And he took the corpse, dismembered it, boiled it up in his great cauldron, and then reassembled the bones for display. And here he is, Charles Byrne, the Irish Giant. Died at the age of 22. He had acromegaly, a tumour of the pituitary gland. So much growth hormone that he grew so large, so young, and died in consequence. But for me, John Hunter is a true hero, because he informs so much of what we do. Even my own research has been influenced directly by him.
His real legacy is not his marvelous museum, but the scientific rigor he passed down through generations of surgeons. Meticulous technique based on detailed anatomical understanding. He helped take surgery from butchery to science, a skilled profession based on real knowledge. Hunter was the founding father of modern surgery.
Hunter more than earned his place in our story. But he has another claim to our attention, as the teacher of the great Edward Jenner. In 1796, Jenner would carry out one of the most important scientific experiments of all time, the results of which would ultimately save millions of lives.
Edward Jenner was a country doctor who lived in the Gloucestershire town of Berkeley. I think he was probably rather a good doctor, but more important, he was a very good scientist, a good observer, a good experimenter, and the idea that he came up with could be said to have saved more lives than any other in medical history.
Jenner was interested in everything. natural history, animal behavior, physics. But his interests in these areas are footnotes to his most important experiment. Edward Jenner took on the number one killer in the 18th century, smallpox. It killed millions, and if it didn't kill you, it could still hideously disfigure you. It was something truly horrible. In 1800, the historian Macaulay said, smallpox was always present, filling the churchyard with corpses, tormenting with constant fear all whom it had not yet stricken, leaving on those whose lives it spared the hideous traces of its power, turning the babe into a changeling at which the mother shuddered, and making the eyes and cheeks of the betrothed maiden objects of horror for the lover. Before Jenner came along, it was widely known that people who'd had smallpox would never get smallpox again. From quite ancient times, the practice of variolation, as it later became called, was done.
That meant infecting people deliberately with smallpox in a way that was hoped, and with some justification, would not give them full-blown smallpox, but would give them an attenuated form.
But this was a very risky practice. Jenner thought a safer alternative might be found in the fields and farms around his surgery.
It was widely believed that milkmaids had beautiful skin, and the reason people believed that was that they didn't get smallpox. Could it be that milkmaids were protected from smallpox by catching cowpox? This was the theory that Jenner wanted to investigate.
Jenner remembered the maxim of his mentor, John Hunter. Don't think, try the experiment. And in April 1796, that's exactly what Jenner did.
A girl called Sarah Nelms caught cowpox from a cow called Blossom that she was looking after. Jenner immediately swung into action. He took pus from Sarah's pustules and deliberately infected a boy called James Phipps, an 8-year-old boy who was the son of his gardener, with cowpox that he got from Sarah. Then, this was the daring part of the experiment, which would never get past an ethics committee nowadays, he deliberately infected James with smallpox. James didn't get smallpox.
This was the key result. Jenner had demonstrated the possibility of vaccination.
The story of Jenner and the milkmaid and the gardener's son is become a kind of iconic story in medical history. It's one of these stories which we like to hear, we like to tell. It kind of conveys the idea in a single vivid moment in history.
Jenner is rightly regarded as the father of immunology, one of the most important medical breakthroughs ever. Many deadly diseases are now avoidable because of immunization. And as for smallpox itself, this is one of the great triumphs of medical science. In 1980, the World Health Organization officially declared it extinct. It's sad that today some people are fearful of vaccinations and stop their children from having them. In Jenner's day, vaccination was a silver bullet which stopped the horrors of a deadly disease and probably saved more children's lives than any other medical advance. He was, I think rightly, hailed as a hero.
What? Hunter and Jenner all used their scientific imaginations practically, transforming the lives of millions. But for me, one of the greatest scientists of the 18th century was a man who had no more thought for the purpose of what he did than a butterfly. Henry Cavendish was the richest man in England, and one of the most brilliant minds since Newton.